Hello everyone, welcome to Lukman IAS. Today we are going to have the Hindu analysis of 31st March 2021. Yes, yesterday there was no edition of the Hindu, therefore there was a break for the Hindu analysis, and now onwards we will continue. This is 31st March, the Hindu analysis. Let us see which are the important articles in today's the Hindu newspaper. Good neighbors. So these are the articles for mains related. We can have relevance for main syllabus and for prelims examination. Let us take overview first of all these articles. First, good neighbors. So from international relations perspective, the article here, editorial page, the editorial is talking about India-Bangladesh relationship and the context of recent visit of our Prime Minister Narendra Modi to Bangladesh. Okay, so here international relations, GS2 paper, India and its neighbors. Next, India does not shine when only some gleam. So the context of the article, again it is talking about the need of inclusive growth, inclusive economic growth and development. So the article is providing certain issues in India's economic growth trajectory, and yes, need of inclusive growth. It is very important topic in GS3 paper economy mains examination. Okay, so we'll have some inputs here, also some data that we have to take as input for supporting our arguments here. Next is Supreme Court to study if POXO Act can be used against minors. So again, important development from social justice part, GS2 paper. The POXO Act 2012 and the amendment in 2019, some of the important salient features of this act, at the same time what are the issues involved here, and what this particular Supreme Court is talking in this particular case here. So with context to this particular news, we are going to understand the issues involved and features of this POXO Act 2012. Next, from international relations prelims related developments, our external minister Jai Shankar says India backs Afghan Taliban dialogue. So for the first time, India has directly mentioned the support to intra-Afghan dialogue. So it is talking about the reference to Taliban, direct reference to Taliban for the first time. Now this is the new initiative or the divergence from the earlier stance that India had. Now the heart of Asia, it is talking about, yes, that particular platform where our external minister has given this view. So heart of Asia process or that particular conference that happened now, some important basics of that particular initiative from prelims related examination here. So next is researchers find new butterfly species. So what is the name of this butterfly species and where it is found? So it is found in Agastyamala Biosphere Reserve in southern India. So some basics about the Agastyamala Biosphere Reserve and which are the biosphere reserves of India. Again, we'll try to revise all these things from environment perspective. Okay, now let us go into details of all these articles and take input for our examination. First, editorial page, good neighbors. So the context is recent visit of our Prime Minister to Bangladesh, and therefore some of the outcomes of this visit, that first we have to understand, then let us understand the areas of cooperation and the issues or concerns involved in the bilateral relationship. Okay, so before going into details or analysis, let us try to understand the outcome of Prime Minister's visit to Bangladesh. So total 5 memorandum of understandings, MOU, were signed in different fields, important fields we can say disaster management. Then we have the MOU between the National Cadet Corps and the parallel agency in Bangladesh. Then we have the MOU on digital services, and next MOU on establishment of sports facilities in those colleges in Bangladesh. All these MOUs are signed. This is important development. Along with these developments, some facilities, initiatives were inaugurated by both PMs in various events we can say. So, release of India-Bangladesh friendship stamps or inauguration of three border hearts, inauguration of Rabindra Bhavan facilities, inauguration of Mitali Express. Now, this is important development from connectivity perspective. Okay, Mitali Express, passenger train between Dhaka and New Jalpaiguri. Okay, so from connectivity perspective, this is again important development. So, this is the outcome of India's Prime Minister's visit to Bangladesh. So, you need to know the recent initiatives, recent developments in the bilateral relations. Okay. So, yes, now we can understand or analyze India's bilateral relationship with Bangladesh. So, areas of cooperation. Now, we can have the contemporary aspects in this analysis. Like areas of cooperation, first and foremost, we can discuss about the trade that, yes, Bangladesh is India's largest trade partner in South Asia. It is India's largest trade partner in South Asia. This information you need to know. The bilateral trade is nearing to $10 billion. Okay, so this is the bilateral trade value, you can understand. So from trade perspective, economic relations perspective, you need to know. The important trade is in jute and jute products. This is also important aspect that you need to know, in which areas the trade is happening. Okay. Second aspect that you need to know is regarding security. So, in security, we can talk about the internal security, that anti-India activities anti-India activities from the soil of Bangladesh have been removed successfully by the Bangladesh government. Now, this is a positive gesture shown by our neighboring country. Okay, so anti-India activities and such groups have been removed from Bangladeshi soil. So, there is some kind of peace and tranquility along the border. Then, the boundary dispute settlement. Now, it is also very important development, because the land boundary agreement 2015 was successfully implemented by amending Indian constitution, and the enclaves from both sides were exchanged here, and India successfully implemented this. Though we had to lose some territory larger as compared to Bangladesh, but we accepted that, and amicably the boundary dispute is settled now. This is the area of cooperation or positive developments in bilateral relationship. Then we have medical tourism. Yes, this is also important. Why? Because almost 35% of international patients coming in India for medical facilities, in terms of medical tourism, they are from Bangladesh. So, it is very important, part of India's revenue from medical tourism, right? So, this aspect we have to understand in areas of cooperation. Connectivity. Now, depending on the location of India's northeastern states and location of Bangladesh. So, yes, through chicken necks, the connectivity to northeastern state is very difficult. And for that matter, the states like Tripura and Mizoram, the connectivity to these states from West Bengal is very easy when it is transited through Bangladesh. And such kind of access is given by Bangladesh itself. Just now we have talked about the kind of connectivity being developed between two countries. So, yes, there is direct bus service from Kolkata to Agartala. Now, this direct bus service has a transit between Bangladesh, and for that matter, it has reduced the distance of 1000 kilometer between these two places, when earlier it had to pass through chicken's neck, right? Now, this distance has reduced to only 500 kilometer. this is how the northeastern states are connected to mainland India. This connectivity is improved because the Bangladesh has agreed to provide transit to such buses. Now, one more thing in connectivity that you need to understand here, that Bangladesh has accepted that its ports like Chittagong port, seaport, is allowed to be used by the northeastern states and their shipments for the export of the goods and import of the goods. So this is also a good development, because for their exports they had to be transported to mainland India and the ports on the mainland India. So this is a very important developments, bilateral developments or areas of cooperation between India and Bangladesh. So whatever the examples, the facts that we have provided here, you need to write them under these headings. Now there are some areas of concerns, or we can say contentious issues, still needs to be solved, or the cooperation between these two countries is less in these areas. The first and foremost, unresolved issue of Tista River water sharing. And yes, during this visit also, the Bangladesh Prime Minister has raised this issue before our Prime Minister, and our Prime Minister has assured the speedy resolution of this particular issue, Tista River water sharing. Next is border killings of civilians. So this has been a bone of contention between two countries. The border killings by BSF and we can say such border security force of Bangladesh. Now these killings of civilians, basically these are civilians, but they are like cattle traffickers. One of the important, let's say, border management challenge along India-Bangladesh border is cattle trafficking. And yes, the border forces like BSF, they are directly killing those traffickers, though they are civilians, and there could have been alternate justice system for such criminals or crimes. So yes, both prime ministers in this particular visit, they have affirmed that such border killings should be minimized and they become zero. Okay, so this is again the good development. They have asked their border forces, respective border forces, to have human oriented border management. Human oriented border management. Use such words in your answer. Human oriented border management. Okay, next aspect that we have to understand, that India is having growing concerns regarding Chinese investment in our neighboring countries, be it Sri Lanka, be it Bangladesh, be it Nepal or Pakistan. So Chinese investment in Bangladesh, especially in terms of infrastructure and such other developments, so this is a bone of contention, we can understand. And yes, India is concerned about more and more such Chinese investment in Bangladesh. Okay, next aspect is NRC. So National Register of Citizens. So this NRC activity, especially in Assam, which to some extent is having concerns because of Bangladeshi migrants and their identity. So how they will be, let's say, repatriated to Bangladesh if their identity is not established. So that is also the concern before the Bangladesh government. So all these are contentious issues between the bilateral relations of India and Bangladesh. Right. So this is how we have to understand the bilateral relationship with Bangladesh, India and Bangladesh. At the same time, you have to understand, whenever the question is asking about how domestic matters, domestic political issues influence the foreign policy of India. So yes, two important issues. One is regarding Tamil issue, Tamil Nadu, and the Sri Lankan government, or we can say India-Sri Lanka relation. And second is this one, West Bengal and Bangladesh. So West Bengal is having some concerns regarding this Tista River water sharing, and for that matter, how these domestic issues are influencing the foreign policy. These are two examples that you need to give in such kind of question. Fine. So from international relations, try to take input. There can be question because there are we are celebrating, or Bangladesh is celebrating 50th anniversary of its independence. And yes, question can be asked from GS1 part also, post independence India Bangladesh. Bangladesh War, Liberation War of 1971. So the question can appear in GS1 paper also. We have already covered from post-independence history in 2 to 3 days back, the Hindu analysis, that particular development. Fine? Okay. Moving on now to the next article. India does not shine when only some gleam. So yes, surely the article is discussing about the inclusive growth, inclusive economic growth. So GS3 paper, every year almost the question is appearing on this inclusive growth kind of, let's say, question. There can be essay topic on inclusive economic growth and development also. The kind of questions that are being asked, first let us have look at them, then only we will understand this issue. Yes, you can see here in 2019 paper, GS3 mains examination, in 2017, let us understand this question. It is argued that the strategy of inclusive growth is intended to meet the objectives of inclusiveness and stability together. Comment on this statement. For that matter, you need to know what constitutes, what are the components of inclusive growth. Then what are the salient features of inclusive growth? Yes, again, the components you need to know here. Has India been experiencing such growth process? Analyze and suggest measures for inclusive growth. Yes, so analysis is also required. So this is how the questions are being asked from the topic inclusive growth. Now let us understand what the article is discussing about, and then in the end we will talk about the inclusive growth. Okay, so yes. You can see here the article is providing some very good insights related to the nature of economic growth that we are going to experience in post-pandemic era. Okay, so the writer is talking about that we need to have new architecture for economic growth in India. We should not move back to the earlier architecture for economic growth. Why? Because the pandemic has changed the situation of Indian economy in last 1 year or 1.5 year. Now you can see here the issues in post-pandemic economic growth. Now what are these issues? The first and foremost is that the growth that we are going to experience or experiencing is, there is lack of inclusive growth. So here itself you need to understand that what do you mean by inclusive growth and what are the constituents or components of inclusive growth. Inclusive economic growth means whatever the economic growth that we are experiencing or any country is experiencing, it is the fruits of that economic growth are shared or are transferred to each and every section of society, are transferred to or given to or experienced or shared to each and every section of society, sector of economy. You can say this is inclusive growth. Now the components of economic inclusive economic growth, you can see here the component first and foremost is that women empowerment. So yes, marginalized sections of society including women, so yes, their development and the growth should be reaching to women also. So women empowerment is important aspect, poverty reduction, employment generation, access to essential service, good governance, equality of opportunities, skill building, so human resource development, all these are components of inclusive growth. Right? This is how we have to understand that inclusive growth includes all these components. Now there is lack of development or there is lack of some of the components in this particular economic growth that we are observing in the post-pandemic area. Okay, so from this we can understand, yes, we can take example of poverty reduction. So poverty is increasing in last 1 year because of impact of COVID-19 pandemic. So in one of the World Bank report recently released on the impact of COVID-19 pandemic on the poverty reduction. So here it has said that almost 75 million people are going to fall under poverty because of impact of this COVID-19 pandemic in India. 75 million people in India will fall below poverty line according to World Bank report on the impact of COVID-19 pandemic. You can give such example whenever there is we are talking about this inclusive growth. Next issue is poor social indices. Here you can give the examples of various indices. For example, here you can give the example of GHI 2020, Global Hunger Index 2020. Here India's ranking has been 94th out of 107 countries, 94th out of 107 countries. So this shows that despite of, let's say, high economic growth and growth rates, we are still experiencing a lack of food security. Okay, it shows there is acute malnutrition in the country, and yes, this shows that the growth is not inclusive. Next issue is growing economic inequities. Yes, growing economic inequities, you can give the example of Oxfam report. You can give the example of Oxfam report and how it shows that the rich people are becoming richer and poor people are becoming poorer day by day, especially after this impact of pandemic. Right. Now, lastly, we can say that the environmental degradation. So, to bring back the economy on the earlier economic recovery path, so the government is taking certain measures and overlooking the environment protection. We can take example of draft economic, EIA, Environment Impact Assessment Notification 2020. EIA, Environment Impact Assessment Rules Notification 2020, issued. They are issued under Environment Protection Act 1986, right? So it shows that the government is preferring more for economic growth and at the expense of environment. So clearance for forest clearances, for deforestation, wildlife, habitat degradation, this is happening, and this is not called as economic inclusive growth now. Okay, so these are the issues involved here, and try to provide certain, facts that we are providing, references to reports and indices in support of your arguments and analysis. So what measures that can be taken? The writer is providing some measures such as the self-governance. Yes, so the local communities are aware about their problem. They are more aware about their resource availability and how to utilize them to solve their own problems. So the focus should be on self-governance in solving these problems and ensuring economic growth, rather than the trickle-down economic growth approach that have been adopted after independence. Okay, this should be the focus of the economic growth, self-governance, and local communities, they should be empowered enough. They should be empowered in terms of funds, functionaries, and functions. So yes, Panchayati Raj institutions, they should be empowered here. Right, next is good governance. That means there should be improvement in fairness, justice, rule of law in the country. And trust in the institutions. So people's trust in the institutions should be improved, be it judiciary, be it executively created statutory or statutory bodies, constitutional bodies. The public trust in these institutions should be improved, and then only the overall governance will be good governance. Automatically the economic growth will be on the right path. And lastly, proactive, pro-poor governance. This is also very important to reduce the poverty, for employment generation, and ensuring the welfare state objective of the government that is enshrined in our constitution, especially if we are talking about the preamble and DPSPs, directive principles of state policies. Proactive governance, pro-poor governance is very important. Right. So here the writer has provided some philosophical reference to Michael Sandel and ideology of individualism. So this particular philosopher is criticizing this Western philosophy of individualism, which believes that person's successes and failures are entirely that person's own responsibility. So this is not the right approach for any kind of society to progress, right? So yes, the poor people in the society are not only poor because of their lack of, having the resources or their lack of capabilities. Rather, such lack of resources and capabilities are the result of the centuries old societal and economic structure in our society. And therefore, such kind of philosophy is not true or suitable for any kind of economic development. Surely that will tumble down, fall in future. Okay, so yes, for inclusive growth and development, we should have the community-led development. Community-led growth and development for sustainable economic growth and inclusive growth. Fine. So this is how we have to analyze and take input whenever the question in GS3 paper, economy part, is on inclusive growth, or there can be essay topic on inclusive growth also. Fine. Okay. Let us move on to the next topic. Supreme Court to study if POCSO Act can be used against minors. So POCSO Act, Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act 2012, amended in 2019. Okay, now this particular act, under this particular act, now Supreme Court is going to examine whether the POCSO Act can be employed to punish teenagers for consensual physical relationship, which later turns so. So this particular case in this article, or the Supreme Court is discussing that one particular or two particular minors, they were in consensual sexual relationship, and later on the the male is being accused of rape by the girl's parents or relatives. So this is how whether that person can be punished under POCSO Act. So this is going to be examined by Supreme Court. We'll have follow-up on this particular case. But right now, let us try to understand the basics about this POCSO Act. Why POCSO Act was very important and needed? So yes, India is signatory to UN Convention on Rights of the Children in 1989. So this convention came into force or signed in 1989. At the same time, we have to understand that in Indian Constitution, we have some fundamental rights for children also. So fundamental rights related to children. Right. If we are talking about fundamental rights given in Article 14, or if we are talking about fundamental rights under Article 21, Article 21A, right to education, and then Article 23, rights against exploitation and trafficking, right? So yes, these are the rights provided टू चिल्ड्रन स्पेसिफिकली डेडिकेटली. एट द सेम टाइम देर आर सम डायरेक्टिव प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ स्टेट पॉलिसीज दैट द स्टेट शुड वर्क कंटिन्यूसली फॉर वेलफेयर ऑफ द चिल्ड्रन. राइट, देर आर मेनी सच डीपीएसपीज डायरेक्टेड टूवर्ड्स द हेल्थ एंड एजुकेशन ऑफ चिल्ड्रन. So yes, these are the constitutional and legal provision, international covenants. For that matter, the need was felt for protecting the rights of the children from, let's say, or protecting the children from sexual offences. So such legislation was enacted by Indian Parliament in 2012. Fine. Now some features, salient features of this particular act that we are talking here. Yes, surely this particular act is gender neutral, that is the children below the age of 18, they are considered as children or minor under this particular act, and it is gender neutral, both male and female children, and they are protected against sexual offenses here. Next important aspect here is that the police person or policemen are to be the protectors of the children and their rights here. Policemen to be the children protectors during the investigation process. So yes, immediately the responsibility of police, whenever the such crime is reported, they are supposed to bring those children before the magistrate or immediately refer to the hospital if there are injuries. At the same time, they should be later on rehabilitated towards in the child welfare homes. Right, so this is the responsibility of police personnel here. The next aspect is that the special courts are to be established under this act for speedy trials, and the case is to be disposed within 1 year when the offense is happened or reporting of the offense is happened. Right. The implementation of this act, the responsibility is given to the statutory bodies like NCPCR and SCPCR, that is National Commission for Protection of Children Rights. This NCPCR is established in 2007 under CPCR. Okay, so Commission for Protection of Children Rights Act 2005. Such statutory bodies, these at the state level, there is we can say state commissions for protection of child rights. These statutory bodies are responsible for implementation of this particular POCSO Act. Along with that, it also has the overriding powers whenever its provisions are in conflict with other legislations. Right. And lastly, mandatory reporting of sexual offenses by the persons who are aware of such offenses. Otherwise, if the person is aware of such offense is happening, such sexual offenses are happening, and if that person, he or she, is not reporting that offense, then he is liable for, or she is liable for punishment. This is how the proactive legislation is passed in India. So these are the provisions. Further, they are amended. The particular act is amended in 2019, and more stringent punishments for sexual offenses have been added, including death penalty for rape cases, especially child rape cases. Okay. Along with that, yes, penalty and punishment, imprisonment for curbing child pornography. Now this is important part of this amendment. Child pornography is banned in India under this act, and legally punishable offense, POCSO Act. Along with that, protection of children from sexual offenses in times of natural calamities. Also, those who are giving certain, let's say, proteins or injections to especially the girls, minor girls, for intention to have sexual penetration. So this is how the widening of definition of sexual offenses is done under this amendment, right? And more stringent punishments are added. Okay, so what kind of questions we can expect in GS2 paper from the social justice part? Discuss the salient features of POCSO Act 2012. They can also ask about 2019 amendments, because UPSC is asking questions from contemporary issues. Now 2 to 3 years we have to cover the contemporary issues, current affairs. Do you think it has been successful in achieving its objectives? Justify your view. So we need to be some skeptical about it, its implementation. For example, what are the issues? Issues, first and foremost, is low rate of conviction in these offenses. Low rates of conviction. You can give the example how judiciary is taking lenient view in these offenses. You can give the example of recent Bombay High Court verdicts on the sexual offenses on children, how this particular act is literally let's say defined, interpreted in narrow manner by even high courts. So this is the issue. The second issue is that yes, some of the sexual offenses are still not covered in this particular act. So again, the definition of sexual offenses need to be broadened further. Along with that, yes, the moral and ethical aspect you need to understand, that our society itself is not adopted here to tackle, and we can say not only tackle, rather report such offenses. What happens is that when the child is coming to the parents or relatives, their trusted ones, in telling them that such kind of incident happened to them, the family tends to ignore them or ask the child to ignore them, because some near and dear ones, close relatives are involved largely in such cases. And this is very poor situation in our society. There's many, even Bollywood films have highlighted such situation. If we are talking about that particular movie of Alia Bhatt, Dear Zindagi, right? So this is how we have to understand that the education in levels in the society, the moral and ethical issues in our society, along with that, there is need of sexual education in our school. This sexual education is not taken seriously in our school curriculum or school education. So if you are talking about have a look at Western countries, the sexual education is taken very seriously, especially in secondary and higher secondary education. So a similar kind of initiatives should be there, and the school curriculum should give more emphasis on the sexual education also. This is how you have to understand the issues as well as way forward. Fine? Okay. So GS2 paper, social justice, even essay paper. Next, Jai Shankar says India backs Afghan Taliban dialogue. Yes. So India has deviated from the earlier stance of not directly referring to Taliban or involvement of Taliban in peace process in Afghanistan, and it has said that it backs intra-Afghan negotiations now, IAN. Now this is again important developments, as India's role in Afghan peace process has been from time to time neglected by various countries, be it Russia or US. So India has taken a new stand here, and it supports or bringing the Taliban in peace process and intra-Afghan negotiations. Now, this particular view was provided by External Affairs Minister at Heart of Asia Conference in Tajikistan. So this was ninth such meeting that happened, or conference of this Heart of Asia. Now this Heart of Asia Istanbul process was the regional initiative of Afghanistan and Republic of Turkey that was launched in 2011. Now every year the countries, some of the countries regional in Asia, they are coming together to provide some let's say measures or initiatives, or we can say that some recommendations, suggestions and deliberations on peace process in Afghanistan and overall in Asia as region. Okay, so what is the motto here of this process? That regional security and cooperation for secure and stable Afghanistan, right? So the secretariat is of Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Afghanistan itself, the Directorate General for Regional Cooperation of Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Now, we have to understand what kind of question that can be asked. So, first thing you need to know that it is the regional initiative of Afghanistan and Turkey. Okay. So, and this year's meeting or conference happened in Tajikistan. Okay. So, yes, practice prelims question. Heart of Asia is the regional initiative of Afghanistan and which of the following other country? So, Pakistan, Iran, Russia, Turkey. So, Turkey is the other nation or the joint initiative, regional initiative, Heart of Asia. Fine? Yes. And next, researchers find new butterfly species. Now, this name of butterfly species is Nakaduba Sinhala Ramaswamy Sadasivan. Okay, this particular species is found in Agasthyamalai in Western Ghats. This particular information, as the current development, you need to know the new species found in Western Ghats, Northeast India or Andaman and Nicobar. So, yes, UPSC can ask such question. Now, basics about Agasthyamalai Biosphere Reserve location. So, it is located at the border of Tamil Nadu and Kerala. You can see here, this is the boundary of, this is Kerala, this is Tamil Nadu. And this is the location, and the core area, buffer area and transition area is shown here in this map. Now, this Agasthyamalai Biosphere Reserve, which is located at the end of Western Ghats in India, south of Nilgiri Biosphere, this particular information you need to know, and they are consisting of some of the protected areas. Which are these protected areas? Yes, wildlife sanctuaries like Shendurni Wildlife Sanctuary, Peppara Wildlife Sanctuary, Neyar Wildlife Sanctuary, Kalakkad Madunterai Tiger Reserve. They are included in this biosphere reserve, these protected areas. At the same time, you also need to know that this particular biosphere reserve is added or included in World Network of Biosphere Reserve, this particular world network maintained by UNESCO. Okay. And yes, Kanikkarans are the aboriginals or original tribal settlers in this particular biosphere reserve. Such kind of statement can be asked. Kanikkarans. Okay. So, you can see here what kind of question in 2019 prelims was asked about this Agasthyamalai Biosphere Reserve. So, which of the following are in Agasthyamalai Biosphere Reserve? Just now we have looked into all these wildlife sanctuaries or protected areas. Neyar Wildlife Sanctuary, Peppar, Shendurni and Kalakkad Mudunterai Tiger Reserve. This is how which of the following protected areas are included in which biosphere reserve. You need to know about this now. Okay, so this is how, yes, you can see here Mudumalai or why not, actually this is Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve. Okay, so most of the students got confused in these two only. Because this Papikonda or Venkateshwara, this comes in Andhra Pradesh, right? So, clear information is required in understanding the locations of these protected areas. Fine, so answer was A. Okay, now some basic information about biosphere reserves of India. Yes, total there are 18 biosphere reserves in India, and out of these 18, 11 are included in this or recognized as under Man and Biosphere Reserve Program, World Network of Biosphere Reserves. Fine. So, which are these 18, and among them, which are the 11 included in that World Network of Biosphere Reserve? From north to south, let us try to first identify those in red mark included in World Network of Biosphere Reserve. First, Nanda Devi. Second, Kanchenjunga. Third, Nokrek. Fourth, Sundarbans. Fifth, Simlipal. Sixth, Achanakmark, Amarkantak. And seventh, Panchamari. Eighth, Nilgiri. Ninth, Agasthyamalai. 10, Gulf of Mannar. 11, Great Nicobar. in Andaman and Nicobar. These are the 11 biosphere reserves included in World Network of Biosphere Reserve. Now remaining ones are Kol Desert, Dihang in Dibang, Dibru Shikoa, Manas, Panna Biosphere Reserve, Run of Kutch Biosphere Reserve, and Sechachalam Biosphere Reserve in Andhra Pradesh. Okay, so basics about biosphere reserves, locations in which state also. So state wise also you need to know that where these biospheres are located. Fine, this is the basic information about biosphere reserve. This must be the revision for you. The first such biosphere reserve included was Nilgiri in this Manan Biosphere or World Network of Biosphere Reserve, and last one is Kanchenjunga in 2018. Fine, okay. So this is important for prelims examination. Yes, these were the articles in today's The Hindu newspaper related to our examination. Try to take input and try to solve as much as MCQs as possible as your prelims examination is nearing day by day. Fine. For further information on editorial discussion classes or ED classes, wherein in-depth analysis of mains related issues and articles is done by Ansari sir and team, you can contact Lukman IAS. Thank you.